general structure of synovial joint. Articular capsule, two-layered outer fibrous capsule of dense irregular connective tissue, continuous with periosteum, inner synovial membrane of loose connective tissue, marked mixed synovial fluid, lines all internal joint surface not covered by cartilage. It means cartilage has a thick layer, an outer layer which is connecting the bone. Last margin of bone is known as periosteum. So one outer layer is attached with the, this layer of articular cartilage attached with the bone, and this thick layer is attached with the, you can see here, this one is yellow, whereas that is purely transparent. Transparent means no blood supply. Yellow mean least blood supply. Red mean maximum blood supply. So the tissues which have maximal blood supply has a capability of healing fastly. The tissues which are yellow in structure mean less supply. They have capability of healing slowly, or sometimes they cannot heal. So we should take all the measures to prevent injury of this cartilage. Synovial fluid, filtrate of blood, contains special glycoproteins, nourishes cartilage and function as a slippery lubricant, weeping lubrication. Okay, there is one lubrication mechanism, how articular cartilage gets its nutrition. It is not in your syllabus, but I would like to add this mechanism of joint lubrication in your syllabus. It is the mechanism by which your articular cartilage gets its nutrition. Okay, that is known as lubrication mechanism, by lubrication mechanism, when you have the slim smaller thing, compress, remove, distract, again filled. Reinforcing ligament. So first and most important characteristic of your synovial joint is presence of articular cartilage, which can give a cushioning effect to joint, prevent bone to bone contact, so prevent damage. Third thing, it can increase the base of support. Suppose something is, this is the base of support, but something, if something cover this, so it can increase the base of support. And when your base of support is increased, your stability will be increased. Clear? So there are three important functions of articular cartilage: increasing base of support, giving soft end feel, soft approximation. Both area, both bones are covered with cartilage. Because of that, both are, there is soft approximation. Because of presence of space between two joints, there is synovial fluid, which can act as a bouncing effect. When you apply pressure, so it can bounce you. That's why you are jumping and running, walking. Next important structure of synovial joint is ligament. I have discussed about synovial fluid, about articular cartilage. Third structure which form the joint, which have an important role is in formation of synovial joint, is ligament. Ligament are the structure which bind one bone to other bone. Okay? Whenever we are standing, joint is, we are stabilized, and stability is because of three things. First, stability comes from joint configuration, like one ball, one socket, and other ball. Okay? Some amount of stability is because of joint structure. If ball is stabilized under socket, but this amount of stability is not enough for our dynamic mobility. Okay? Static stability of joint is provided by joint configuration or articulation, and second is by connection of one bone to other bone by means of ligament. Ligaments are soft tissues, denser rope-like structure. They can bind one bone to other bone, and by means of binding during static posture, when our forces are balanced, according to Newton's first law, gravity is applying ground reaction forces over our body, and our muscle, ligament, body weight is applying same amount of pressure. And when both pressures are equal, we are stabilized. So during a static posture, when we are not moving, stability to our body is provided by ligament and joint configuration. But what happens when we move? When we are stabilized, it is keeping like this. Ligaments are attached, we are stable. But when we start moving, the ball, when we are going flexion, ball will come forward. Extension, ball will go backward. Adduction, ball will come inside, abduction, outside, rotation. So it means we have disturbed the stability of joint configuration. During movement, your ball is going in, out, anywhere, any direction. It means configuration become unstabilized. The movement of inertia is disturbed. Next thing, because ligaments are attached from one bone to other bone, they will be continuously moving. So these In dynamic posture, your ligaments and your joint or bony configuration is not sufficient to provide stability to your body. So how can we get stabilized when we are moving? It is the muscle. It is the muscle which is dynamic stabilizer of our body. You know, when we are walking, there are two phases: swing phase, stance phase. The foot which is on ground, when foot is on ground, we will say it is stance phase, and when foot is on off the ground is swing phase. So by completing swing and stance phase, it is known as gait. Gait is a scientific pattern of walking. What is gait? Gait is the scientific pattern of walking. It means when you are going stance and swing, stancing, by this means you can accelerate. Then what happens when you are in single limb stance? It means your other leg is going to put on ground. So your center of gravity is above than normal level. It means above 2S2. And when you are in double limb stance, your COG is lower 2S2. It means in both condition, you are unstabilized. I am saying, what is stability? When your center of gravity rested just anterior to S2. Clear? But when you start walking, you have disturbed your moment of inertia. It means your static position is walking. Is disturbed, you are going, moving. Clear? So it means when you are in single stance, your center of gravity is above than S2. And when you are going for both limb stance, center of gravity is lower than S2. It means in both conditions, you are unstabilized. But because even we are unstabilized, we are not falling down. It means there are some forces which are controlling us going towards gravity. These are the muscle which can give us stability. They are by continuous contraction, by continuous firing, they are controlling our body even in continuously moving bones. Clear? So we have discussed about ligament. Ligament and bones give us static stability. Now come to nerves. Detect pain, monitor stretch. One of the ways of sensing posture and body movement. What is posture? Normal alignment. Normal body alignment along with bones and muscle. So, synovial joint has articular cartilage, it has synovial fluid, it has ligament, it has nerve. It means all the structure which is responsible for all the activity. Either nerve is there, muscle is there, bone is there, ligament is there, fascia are there. So all the structure which make our body a complex structure are present in synovial joint. So detect pain, because if we have any injury in joint, nerve is available there, and nerve can inform brain ki this area is injured. So we can take proper precautionary measure, we can take proper treatment to get that joint cured. Imagine if we don't have any nerve supply in the synovial joint, what happens? Even with injury, we cannot notice it. And we are using it, and we can completely damage the joint. So because of presence of nerve, we can immediately get aware that there is some pathology, there is some injury in our muscle or ligament or joint. So we can take proper action immediately. Next is blood vessels. Rich blood supply, extensive capillary bed in synovial membrane produce the blood filtrate. I am saying that there is no blood supply for your articular cartilage, but there is enough supply in joint. Okay, blood vessels are coming, supplying to synovial fluid, and synovial fluid has rich amount of blood supply. That's why blood is giving nutrition to synovial fluid, and synovial fluid is giving nutrition to your articular cartilage. General structure of synovial joint. So we have seen joint is made up of periosteum, ligament, joint cavity, which is filled with synovial fluid, articular cartilage, fibrous capsule, and synovial membrane. Synovial membrane is a barrier between your bone, cartilage, and fluid. Synovial membrane is a barrier between your, otherwise what happens? Fluid can get leak. If you are not confining any fluid with a boundary, it can flow, because it is not a solid mass. So membrane is a structure which can retain the synovial fluid. But if you have any injury in membrane, it can leak the fluid, and this is the main cause of development of arthritis. and it is the membrane which is responsible for diffusing. Diffusion mean, you know what is diffusion? Always higher concentration, lower concentration moves towards higher concentration. Always lower concentration moves towards higher concentration. If you put grapes in a concentrated sugar solution, clear? What happened? After some time you can feel that grapes is wrinkled because all the content which was available within the grapes comes out. If you put some kishmish in the water, after some time you can feel that kishmish is swell up because kishmish content has higher amount of solution, higher concentration in comparison to water concentration. So this is the rule of diffusion. Always higher, lower concentration moves towards higher concentration. So when we see here synovial fluid, you can feel like egg yolk. You've seen yolk, whitish component of yolk. So synovial fluid is sticky like this. It's a viscous component. Okay. So when there is any compression, the nutrition available in fluid can go into the articular cartilage, and when there is compression, the articular cartilage based material comes out from the cartilage and managed via the synovial fluid. Clear? You all know about the blood exchange. Normally we take fresh blood from our artery and that blood go to cells. There is reaction and oxygen and glucose of the cell is utilized, and end product is water and CO2, which is again go to veins blood. From veins it will go to heart, from heart to lungs, and from lungs it will go out, as well as extra or excrete water will be excreted from the kidney. So this is a mechanism. When your cartilage utilizes the nutrition, and after utilization there is always there is waste. When you use anything, there will be some waste. It is a natural law. Same as when your cartilage is taking nutrition, after eating the nutrition it will have some waste. That waste again come to synovial fluid. From synovial fluid it will go to veins. From veins it can be managed throughout the different excretory system and go out of the body. So these are the structure which frame a synovial joint, and they are very important structure. Periosteum is the bone, outer covering of the bone, ligament which bind bone to bone, joint cavity, the space available between two joints, articular cartilage, the softened softer bone-like structure. You can see, if you are non-vegetarian, you can feel there is a white bone here, transparent, totally transparent. This is cartilage type. This is a cartilage. As well as when you break a joint, there is some soft, harder-like structure, that is cartilage. Fibrous capsule. Fibrous means membranous, like fiber. They are encircling the fibrous capsule is made up of synovial membrane. They are membrane-like structure which makes boundary for your synovial membrane. Bursa and tendon sheath contain synovial fluid, not joint, but often we have not discussed this. Bursa, you may have heard about bursa, fascia, tendon. Okay, so tendon you are very familiar with tendon, but bursa and fascia, if you see the structure of muscle, you may see. Imagine a rope. Rope, if you see rope very closely, it is made up of very thin fiber. Many thin fiber makes one more thick rope. Many thick rope make more thick rope, like electrical wire. If you cut a thicker electrical wire cable, three wires are insulated in one cable. Again you cut, three more wires are insulated in one. So like there, muscle, very thin fiber, five fiber make, they are tubercollagen. Five fiber encircle in a wire like plastic, copper wire. You can imagine from your electric wire. There are thin copper wire. 5 to 10 copper wire are encircled in a plastic sheet. Okay? One green, one red, one yellow. Again, that is again encircled in a black. And if you see a very thick wire, many black are encircled in the rubber. So these rubber, which are encircling the fibers, the rubber, insulation, which are encircling the fiber, same as muscle. Very thin fiber, five thin fiber make one more thick fiber, then five fiber more thick. So this type hierarchical structure of muscle. When we will talk about muscle, we will discuss it. So, fascia. Fascia is a membrane which covers the inner layer. Same, it is present in nerve. Nerve, you have seen axon. Very thin fiber. Five axon is covered by one. This is no blackboard, I can explain the things. But when we will discuss muscle, we will explain each and everything. Fascia is a structure which are acting as an insulation material, which is binding 5 or 10 fibers. Then, bursa. Muscles are attached with bone. Muscles are attached with bone. But muscles are not directly attaching. There is some intervening material which are attaching your muscle to bone, same as somewhere skin is attached to bone. Somewhere skin is, suppose if you see here, there is no muscle at all. Over bony prominences, your skin is directly attached to bone. But skin cannot directly attach to bone. It needs some adhesive structure which can attach your skin to bone. So this is a one intervening material known as bursa, which connect. You have seen that dhol. There's membrane. You can use it. When you hold leather, inside the leather there is membrane, and we can use that membrane for making dholes. That is bursa. Bursa is an intervening material which can connect two different types of tissue. Muscle is totally different from bone. If we want to attach muscle over bone, there is one membrane which can connect bone to muscle, which can connect skin to bone, is a material known as bursa. Clear? Bursa and tendon sheath contains synovial fluid, not joint, but often associated with them, act like ball bearing. Bursa means purse in Latin, flattened sac lined by synovial membrane where ligament, muscle, tendon or bone overlie each other and rub together. It acts as a insulating material. It can separate different things by making a over outlining. If you remember your muscle structure, endomysium, perimysium and epimysium. So, I am discussing about synovial joint. Synovial joint is made up of it contains all the structure. Bursa is there, tendon is there, ligament is there, fascia is there, nerves are there, blood supply are there. So, if there are all structure, that's why it has all function. The person who eat more can work more. Same as this synovial joint has all the structure which are important for body function. That's why it is very important for function. So, we are going to discuss about this shoulder joint. You can see here from acromion scapularis bone. Acromion is bone. Then there is a coracoacromial ligament. Coracoacromial ligament. Then subacromial bursa. Subacromial bursa. It is the bursa which is connecting your cartilage with bone. It is the bursa, your cartilage with bone. It is acting as a connecting material. Then fibrous articular capsule. Suppose if you are trying to put a plant in a pot. You are going to put plant, then you need to fill that pot with clay. So clay is acting as a capsule. After putting your ball, synovial articular cartilage, some space is empty. But if there is empty space, it cannot give you proper stability. To make joint proper stable, we should fill the vacant space by some tissues known as joint capsule. Tendon sheath, synovial membrane, these are the structure. Now we will discuss the dynamic component of muscle stability, dynamic component. We have discussed static stability when we are in a static posture. Static stage, the stability of body is provided by ligament as well as bony contour. But how muscle give you stability? When we are walking, when we are walking, COG is highest point. So, our muscle will apply a pressure to bring that COG down. By this, how much COG is going up, muscle will act opposite to that and bring the COG down, we will become stabilized. But sometime muscle will act more, so COG is going down. So by this mechanism, COG up and down, and body is trying to balance the COG. And in this process we walk. Walking is not our voluntary thing. When we start walking, COG go up. Body will try to bring it down. But when it try to bring it down, it will go deeper, more down. So again, body will try to bring it up, again more up. So by this imbalances, we walk. Clear? Now application of synovial joint in our body. As I have told you, synovial joint has a great degree of freedom. Number of planes and movements are much more. Joint stability. We will discuss stability. Articular surface, I have told you, shape usually plays only minor role. Some deep socket or groove to provide stability, ligament usually to more. The strong the joint can stretch only 6% beyond normal length. Before tear, one stretch, stay stretch. Okay? So ligament has ability to stretch only 6% of its length. Suppose if a ligament is 10 centimeter long, so it has stretching capability of only 60 millimeter. If a ligament is 6 centimeter long, it has capability to stretch by only 60 millimeter, and you are going for this amount of range, it cannot stretch so long. So it is failed to provide you stability. So in those conditions, muscle is the tissue which can provide you stability. Constant low level of contractile force keep tension on ligament, especially important in shoulder, knee, arches of foot. There are two more things. Shoulder joint and hip joint, both are type of ball and socket joint. Both are synovial joint and they are example of ball and socket joint. But if you talk about stability, hip joint is more stable than shoulder joint. And if you talk about mobility, shoulder joint is more mobile in comparison to hip joint. That's why shoulder joint is more prone to get injured. And injury is either because of overuse or because of more range. Sometimes you are going the range, you are achieving the range which is above your limit of ligament, tendon and muscle. And if you go over that range, muscle can tear, sometime ligament can tear, sometime your bony configuration can disturb. Sometime when you are putting repeated stretch over there, the ligament or your tendon can stretch. So mechanism of injury is mainly two types. One is macro failure. You are putting any excessive load which is out of the limit of your weight bearing capability of ligament or tendon. Major failure. You will notice your athlete will come to you directly, sir, I have did this and got severe pain. It means major failure, that he has gone through a high stress and damage. Sometime patient is playing and after some 1 month, 2 month, 3 month or 6 month or 1 year, he will come, sir, I have problem here. So there are both type of injury is possible in shoulder joint or all synovial joint. And joint injury is not because of injury to, we are always consider joint is because of bone. But joint doesn't mean only bone. Joint mean all structure, muscle, ligament, tendon, synovial membrane, synovial fluid. And if there is any disturbances in any one of the component of joint, we will have pain because the synovial joint is fully innervated structure. And the structure which are innervated in the body have capability of showing pain. So I am discussing about the repeated injury, rotator cuff injury, more common in athletes which are using shoulder, like basketball player, tennis player, all sports activities which require your shoulder range of motion. And because of overuse, when you are going for any range of motion activity, it means during dynamic activities, your muscles are subjected to stress. And suppose muscle is made up of thousands of fiber arranged in a structure. Suppose you have did any without warm up, you go for any activity. Without warm up, you go for any activity you can do. Even the player who can play after, who is playing. Suppose you are not playing for last 6 months and suddenly you go and play. You can play. But after 4 to 6 hours, you will feel severe pain. Again, next day you can feel severe pain. For 2 to 3 days, you are feeling pain. What is this? This is DOM, delayed onset of muscle soreness. Because your body was not prepared to perform that activity, or your body was not conditioned for performing that activity, and you do it. So that time you can do. But after 4 to 6 hours, when you during that activities you have tear some of the tissues, but not majorly. Some of the tissues can tear, and when they will get tear, there will be some inflammatory reactions, and because of those reactions, inflammatory reaction, some chemical will releases from the damaged cell, which will go to your body and stimulate your receptors. We will discuss in next chapter how we can feel pain, and we are feeling pain after 4 to 6 hours. And when you have sudden injury, you are feeling pain just immediately. We will discuss in next chapter how both pain can be perceived, which pain can be felt after 4 hours, which pain can be felt immediately. And this is the because of joint, because joint doesn't mean only bone and bone. Joint is a full-fledged structure. It is made up of all the tissues, bone, ligament, tendon, fascia, bursa, and there is a full chances of pathology in all structure. So if any person come to us with any joint problem, we should be able to assess the integrity of each and every component of the joint.
Dear students, today we are going to discuss a very important system of our body called digestive system. Before we discuss the digestive system, let us first see what is the purpose of this system. In our body, we have different many systems, and every system has a purpose. There is no system which does not have a purpose in our body. So digestive system also has a purpose. Now let us first see what is the purpose of digestive system. Our body performs different functions. For example, our heart contracts 24 hours. We respire, we take oxygen in and give carbon dioxide out. We have to move from one place to another to fetch food, to make ourselves safe from different hazards. So these are the different functions which our body performs, or we can say this is the work our body performs. And as you know, every work needs energy. So this energy which we require comes from the food that we take or that we eat. Food which is available around us, whether it's from the animal source or the plant source, we take that food for solving our energy problems. Now there is a problem that the food that's available to us, whether it is from the plant source or the animal source, is in such a form that our body cannot utilize it. Basically, our body utilizes very small molecules of the food. However, the food that is available is in a form that is, I can say that it is in the present in the large molecular form, and our body cannot utilize it. So the first thing that digestive system does for us is that it breaks down the larger molecules of food into the smaller ones so that our body can utilize it. And this process is called as digestion. So digestion may be defined as the breaking down of the larger molecules of food into the smaller molecules. Now, after the food is digested, it has also to reach our blood. Unless and until it does not reach the blood, it cannot reach to our cells, and our cells cannot utilize it. The next thing which the digestive system does is that it also provides us the route through which the food enters our body, and after entering in the body, after digesting in the digestive system, it also takes it to our blood. And this passage of food after digestion in the stomach to the blood or the lymph is called absorption. So we can say by the process of digestion and absorption, digestive system provides us a continual supply of nutrients, electrolytes and water. As I mentioned earlier, that we need food or nutrients for our energy. But besides nutrition, we also need certain electrolytes, minerals, as well as water. These are also essential, and it is the digestive system that provides us these three elements: nutrients, electrolytes, and water. Now, if we see the functions of the digestive system, it becomes easier for us now to say that digestive system performs two functions. One is digestion and second is absorption. Now, digestion, which I mentioned earlier, is the process in which the larger molecules of food are broken down into smaller molecules. This digestion is accomplished by two different processes. One process is movements and second is secretions. By movements, we mean the movement of the food through different areas of the digestive tract. See, if the food does not move in the digestive tract, it cannot be digested, it cannot be absorbed, and therefore it cannot serve the purpose for which it is meant. For example, if we take the food and place it in the mouth and it does not move forward from mouth to the esophagus and then to the stomach, it cannot be utilized. Unless the food from the mouth goes into the stomach, stomach will act on the food through different enzymes, through acid, and will digest it. And from the stomach, if it does not move to the intestines, it cannot be further digested and it cannot be absorbed. So movements of the food is very essential for accomplishment of digestion. And second thing which is important for secretion, for digestion, sorry, is the secretions. Our digestive system secretes many different enzymes and digestive juices to digest the food, that is to break down the food from larger molecules into the smaller molecules. Now, if we elaborate the functions of the digestive system, as I mentioned earlier, we can say that the digestive system performs movements, number two, secretions, and these two lead to digestion and secretion. So these are the four functions which digestive system performs, but we can add some more functions to it. For example, before the food can be digested or absorbed, it needs to be ingested. Unless and until we does not eat the food does not go inside, it cannot be digested or absorbed. So first thing, first function is all, which can be added to it is the ingestion of food. And one more function can be added to it, that after the food is digested and absorbed, whatever is left and whatever is unwanted and not digested, it has to be expelled from the body, and that process is called defecation. So now if we see the functions of the digestive system, these are ingestion of the food, movement of the food through different parts of the digestive tract, secretion of various enzymes for digestion, finally digestion of the food, after digestion, absorption of the food, and at last defecation. Now let us discuss these functions one by one. First, let us take the movements. Movements, as I said earlier, is the movement of the food through different parts of the digestive tract. There are different types of movements. For example, we first take the food into the mouth, then we chew the food, then it is swallowed, then in the esophagus it moves down, then in the stomach there are different types of movements. So overall in GIT there are so many different types of movements, but from the point of view of functions, these can be divided into two basic group of functions, basic group of movements. One is the propulsive movement, second is the mixing movements. Propulsive movements are those movements which may cause food to move forward. And mixing movements are those movements which mix the food, which keep the contents thoroughly mixed, that is they mix the food with the secretions. Now if we see the propulsive movements, in our GIT, the basic propulsive movement is called peristalsis. Peristalsis may be defined as the wave of contraction followed by a wave of relaxation which travels in an annulward direction. Now if you see how the peristalsis takes place, if you imagine a tube, a soft tube filled with some soft material, and if you put your fingers around it, make a constriction there, and then take this constriction forward, the contents inside the tube will be moved forward. This is how the propulsion of food takes place, and this kind of movement is called peristalsis. Same happens in our GIT, that first a contractile ring is formed around the gut, and this contractile ring then moves forward. And just behind the contraction, the area is automatically is relaxed subsequently. In this diagram, you can see I have shown that around the food bolus, which is present in the intestine or somewhere else, a constriction ring is formed. That constriction ring then moves forward, and in this way, food is propulsed, is moved forward. And this type of movement is called peristalsis. One more thing which is important related to the peristalsis is that this movement is always in the analverse direction. That is, peristalsis takes place from mouth towards the anus. It cannot be in the reverse direction, that it does not move towards the mouth under normal circumstances. Now let us see the second function, that is secretions. So many different secretions take place in our GIT. Let us start from the mouth. In mouth, there is a secretion called saliva, and this is secreted by glands called salivary glands. Then we will come to the stomach. In stomach, there are two very important secretions. One is the acid. Second is an enzyme called pepsin. Liver is an organ of the accessory organ of the digestive system, which secretes a secretion called bile. Another accessory organ of digestive system is pancreas. This pancreas secretes a cocktail of enzymes, so many different types of enzymes, which are very essential for the digestion of the food. In fact, the enzymes present in the pancreas digest all types of food. That is, if we divide the food, it can be divided into three categories: carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. Pancreas has the enzymes for all the three groups: enzymes for the digestion of the fats, enzymes for the digestion of carbohydrates, and enzymes for the digestion of proteins. One more secretion which is very important in the digestive system, in the gastrointestinal tract, is mucus. There are so many glands in our digestive system from mouth to anus that secrete mucus. There are single cell glands as well as compound glands that secrete mucus. Mucus is a very important secretion in the digestive system. It performs the function of protection. It lubricates our digestive system so that it saves it from abrasions, tear, and action of different enzymes. Now you can see the secretions in the nutshell, various enzymes that are secreted by digestive system: HCl, acid, bile. These three secretions, enzymes, acid, and bile, they aid in digestion. Then another secretion is the mucus, and this, as I said earlier, is the protective secretion. Now we will see the enzymes that are present, that are secreted in our digestive tract. Let us start from the mouth. Salivary amylase, this is the enzyme present in our saliva. Pepsin, this is an enzyme, proteolytic enzyme. It digests the proteins, and it is secreted by the stomach. Then trypsin, chymotrypsin, and carboxypeptidase. These are three proteolytic enzymes that are secreted by the pancreas into the intestines. Pancreas also secretes pancreatic lipase. These enzymes digest the fats, and pancreas also secretes pancreatic amylase. This enzyme is required for the digestion of carbohydrates. Now let us see the organs of the digestive system. What comprises our digestive system? What are the parts of our digestive system? Before we discuss different parts of the digestive system, let us see the general build of our digestive system. Digestive system is basically a simple muscular tube that extends from mouth to the anus, a simple muscular tube. There are also certain accessory organs that are associated with it. However, this simple muscular tube is modified at various places. At some places, it is distended like a bag, like our stomach. At some places, its anatomy is such that it's coiled, for example, our small intestines. And there are certain variations in the internal structure of the digestive system also. Every part of digestive system has an anatomy, and this anatomy or this structure is according to the need of that part. Whatever is the function of that part, it has been given that type of structure, that type of anatomy. This tube that extends from the mouth to anus is also called as alimentary canal or gastrointestinal tract. Now, the organs of the digestive system, these can be divided into two groups: primary digestive organs and the accessory digestive organs. Let us first see what are the primary digestive organs. First, mouth, then pharynx. Pharynx is basically a funnel shaped structure that is just behind the mouth. Then esophagus, it's a tube that connects the pharynx with the stomach. It's just behind our sternum. Then stomach, it's a bag like structure. Small intestines, the tube like structure is coiled, and finally the large intestines. Small intestine can be further divided into three parts. The first part of the small intestine is called the duodenum. It's in the shape of an inverted C just after the stomach. Then comes the jejunum, and finally the last part of the small intestine is called ileum. Similarly, large intestine can be divided into certain parts. The first part where the small intestine joins the large intestine is called cecum. It is an expanded structure. Then ascending colon, the large intestine that goes in the upward direction, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid, rectum, and anus. What are the accessory digestive organs? Accessory, these are not the part of the main digestive tract, but they are associated with it, and they help in many different functions of the digestive system. These are called as accessory digestive organs. These are teeth, tongue, salivary glands, pancreas, and liver. This is the diagrammatic representation of the digestive tract. You can see the mouth, then the funnel shaped structure is called the pharynx. The tube that goes down towards the stomach is called esophagus. Then you can see the stomach, duodenum, that C, inverted C shaped structure. Then the coiled portion, small intestines, and then large intestines. First, you can see the cecum, the extended part, ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid, rectum, and anus. Now, in the digestive system, we are going to discuss an accessory organ called tongue. Tongue, as all of us know, is basically a muscular structure. It is situated in our mouth. It's whole muscle, and it's covered by a mucous membrane. Now, this tongue, this extends in our mouth from pharynx, upper part of the pharynx, in the oral cavity. So, it can be divided into two parts: pharyngeal part, the part of the tongue that lies in the pharynx, and the most of the tongue that remains in the mouth is called the oral part. So, we can say there are two parts of the tongue: oral part and pharyngeal part, and both these parts are separated from each other by a V-shaped sulcus. Sulcus means a groove, and this sulcus is called sulcus terminalis. This tongue has the muscles, and these muscles are voluntary skeletal muscles. That means that the muscles which are present in our tongue, they are under voluntary control. They are under our will. We can move it on our will. The length of the tongue is about 3 centimeters, and it is very mobile. You can move it from one direction to another. You can move it upwards, downwards. You can roll it inside your mouth. But despite the fact that it is very mobile, we never swallow our tongue, because it's anchored to different organs in our mouth and pharynx.
And posteriorly, it's anchored to the hyoid bone. It's a bone found in our pharynx. It's anchored to the mandible. It's attached to the mandible. And it's also attached to the soft palate. Tongue can broadly be divided into three parts. The root, the posterior part that is in the pharynx. Body, the main portion of the tongue. And the tip. The body of the tongue has two surfaces. The superior surface, which is also called as dorsum, and the inferior surface of the tongue, which is usually very smooth. If you roll your tongue upwards, you can see the inferior surface of the body of the tongue. You must have observed your tongue on a mirror, and you have seen that it's very rough from on the dorsum, on the superior surface. This roughness of the tongue is basically due to the projections which are present on the mucous membrane of the tongue. And these projections are called as papilla of the tongue. And these papilla give tongue the characteristic roughness. These papilla are of three types. First, circumvallate papilla. These are the largest of the papilla found in our tongue. These are about 1 to 2 mm in size, and their number is about 8 to 12. And they are arranged in an inverted V shape. If you observe your tongue on the mirror, you can see at the back of the tongue, these are the circumvallate papilla are there in an inverted V shape. Another type of papilla which is found on the tongue is called as fungiform papilla. They are in large numbers, and they are usually present on the tip and on the margins. These papilla, fungiform papilla, are identified by their bright red color. You can see on your tongue there are some papilla which are very bright and red in color. The third type of papilla which is present on our tongue are the filiform papilla. They usually cover the central portion of our tongue, and they are smallest of the all the three papillas, and they are numerous in number, and it's because of these filiform papilla that our tongue has a velvety appearance, that rough appearance you can see on your tongue. Here you can see the diagram of the tongue showing the fungiform papilla on the tip and the margins, the filiform papilla, and the largest circumvallate papilla in the V-shaped form at the posterior of the tongue. Now, what are the functions of the tongue? The first function which the tongue performs is the function of taste. We taste different many things. We eat food because we like some foods because of its taste. And this perception of taste, this sense of taste is because of the tongue. Its tongue is the organ which gives us the sensation of the taste. Second important function of the tongue is the speech. We cannot speak without tongue. If a person does not have a tongue, he cannot speak. So this tongue helps in the articulation and in the speech. Third function of the tongue is the mastication. Mastication means chewing of the food. When we take the food and start chewing it in our mouth, the food is chewed by our teeth, but the tongue helps in chewing. It pushes the food always towards the teeth so that it can be properly chewed. The movement of the tongue is very important during the chewing or the mastication. And another function which the tongue performs is swallowing. When the food is chewed properly and is ready to be swallowed, it's our tongue that pushes it backward towards our pharynx. The tongue is lifted upwards and backwards, and it pushes the food into the pharynx. So the tongue also helps us in swallowing. So the functions of the tongue are taste, speech, mastication, and swallowing. Now, if we see the first function of the tongue, that is taste. It's a very important function of the tongue, and taste is a sensation that, along with the sense of smell, helps us to distinguish undesirable or even lethal foods from those that are nutritious. It is the sense of taste and smell combined that helps us in identifying the foods that are nutritious, that are good for us, and also to eliminate the foods that are harmful, that may be toxic, that may be rotten. We avoid those foods because of these two sensations combined, taste and smell. Even our liking of food depends on the taste and smell. Now, four different types of taste senses have been identified. These are sour, salty, sweet, and bitter. These are basically the four primary tastes. Like in colors, we have red, blue, and yellow. From these three colors, red, yellow, and blue, you can make hundreds of colors. Similarly, these four primary tastes of the tongue, sour, salty, sweet, and bitter, we can appreciate thousands of tastes. All the tastes, in fact, are the combination of these four elementary tastes. Now, the taste sensation is basically the function of the taste buds. Tongue is basically a muscular structure. It is covered by the mucous membrane. So, how it perceives the taste? Taste is perceived because of the taste buds that are present in our tongue. The papilla in our tongue, which we mentioned earlier, they contain the taste buds. Taste buds are in fact located on those papilla, except from the filiform papilla. All other papilla have the taste buds. Taste buds are present there. Additionally, there may be taste buds in the on the soft palate, in the epiglottis, and sometimes even we have taste buds in the proximal esophagus also. So it's because of these special sensory organs called taste buds that we appreciate the taste. That how our tongue appreciates the taste because of the taste buds. Now, if we examine a taste bud, it's basically composed of about 50 cells which are modified epithelial cells. And among these 50 cells, most of the cells are the supporting cells, and very few cells, these are called as taste cells. These are the cells, special cells, nervous cells, which examine or which appreciate the taste. Now, these cells, these taste cells, which are surrounded by the supporting cells in a taste bud, their tips are arranged around a small pore called the taste pore. Their tips are arranged in a circular fashion around a pore. And from the tip of these taste cells, small hairs, hair-like projections come out, which protrude into the pore and approach the oral cavity. So whenever we take the food, this food reaches into our taste pores, and these hair-like projections on these taste cells, they perceive the chemical sensation of the food or the taste of the food, and they send the signals to our nervous system through the nerves where we appreciate the taste. So here you can see the taste bud within the muscles of the tongue. You can see the supporting cells and then the taste cells. There are small hair-like projections coming out of the tips of these cells, and they are all arranged around a small pore called the taste pore. So this is, so because of these taste buds, the tongue performs the function of the taste. This is a very important function of the tongue. Now, friends, we are going to discuss another accessory organ of our digestive system, and that is teeth or tooth. If we see the tooth or teeth in our mouth, the portion that is visible to us, the white portion that is visible to us, is called the crown. But there is also a part of the tooth that is hidden inside our jaw that is called the root. So the tooth has two parts, crown that's above the gums, and the root that lies within the bony sockets of the jaw. And there we can say there is also a third part called the neck, that is a part between the crown and the root. That is a small depression or the narrow portion of the tooth that's called as neck. So the tooth can be divided into crown, the portion that protrudes out from the gum into the mouth, root, the portion that lies within the bony socket of the jaw, and the neck, that is the collar between the crown and the root. Now, if we cut our tooth in a sagittal section means when we cut in this direction of our body, we can see different layers in a tooth. The outermost layer is called the enamel. Now, this is the outer surface of the tooth, and it is the hardest part of the tooth. This part, enamel, which covers the tooth, the outermost layer, this is the hardest part of the tooth, and this is resistant to the acids, to the chemicals, and even to the mechanical pressure. This is basically this layer which protects our tooth and makes our tooth very hard. Now, inside this layer, enamel, is the another layer called dentin. This dentin forms the main body of the tooth, and its composition is almost similar to the bones of our body. So this is also hard, but not as hard as the enamel. So outer layer, enamel, then the second layer of the tooth is dentin. Inside this is the pulp or the pulp cavity. There's a small cavity inside our tooth which is called as pulp cavity, and this pulp cavity contains connective tissues, nerves, blood vessels, everything. Basically, blood supply and the nerves are present in the pulp. That's why you have seen that whenever there is some cavity in our tooth, unless and until it does not reach the pulp, we does not feel any pain, because the nerve fibers are located in this pulp. Another layer which we can see in the cut section of the tooth is called the cementum. Cementum is basically a bony substance which lines the tooth socket and holds the tooth in place. You can see this in the diagram. This is a cut section of the tooth. Here you can see the outermost layer, the enamel, the hardest part, then inside the dentin, which resembles composition to our bones and forms the main body of the tooth. And then the third is the pulp, the innermost layer is a pulp cavity. It contains the nerves which makes our tooth sensitive, and blood vessels that provide nutrition to our bones, to our tooth also. And then you can see this layer that holds the tooth in the socket called the cementum. Next thing which we are going to discuss about our tooth is the dentition. In our lifetime, we develop two sets of the teeth. First is called the milk teeth or the deciduous teeth. These are the first teeth that appear in our life. That's when we are little children or infants. These milk teeth, they are usually 20 in number, and they start to erupt at the age of 7 months and up to 2 years. So they erupt between 7 months to second year of the life. And these teeth, these milk teeth or deciduous teeth, they last until 6th to 13th year of age. These are the first set of teeth which we develop. Second set of teeth is called the permanent teeth. As we grow, the milk teeth are one by one replaced by the permanent teeth. The milk teeth start to fall off, and these are replaced by the permanent teeth, and these teeth then last long in our lifetime. So these milk teeth when replaced by the permanent teeth, milk teeth are 20 in number, permanent teeth will be also 20 in number. However, there are additional 8 to 12 molars that appear posteriorly in the jaw. Therefore, the total number of permanent teeth that we develop, that we erupt in the later age stages of our life, is 28 to 32. So the total number of the permanent teeth is 28 to 32. So we have two sets of dentition: primary teeth or milk teeth, and second permanent teeth. Milk teeth are 20 in number, permanent teeth are 32 in number. Milk teeth appear at the age of 7 months to the second year, and they last for 6 to 13 years. Permanent teeth start to appear from 6th year onwards, and they last the lifetime. Here you can see here I have shown you the permanent set of teeth. The teeth in the middle will start from the middle of our mouth, central incisors, then beside the central incisors are the lateral incisors, then canines, then first premolar, second premolar. First molar, second molar, and third molar. So you can count is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 teeth on this side. Similarly, 8 will be on this side, making 16 in the lower set and 16 on the upper set, a total of 32 teeth. However, in the milk teeth, we don't have the molars. So we will have the central incisor, lateral incisor, canine, first premolar, and second premolar. The number will be 5 on this side and 5 on this side, that is 10 on the lower jaw and 10 on the upper jaw, making a total of 20 milk teeth. Now, what are the functions of the teeth? Teeth perform the function of cutting, grinding, and mixing of the food. The teeth cut the food, they grind the food, and they mix the food. And for this purpose, teeth, they are also provided with a powerful jaw muscles. Teeth combined with the muscles of our jaw, they help in these functions of cutting and grinding our food. The muscles of the jaw provide a very strong force between our teeth for these functions. If you we can see here, the front teeth, they create, along with the muscles of the jaw, create a pressure of 50 to 100 pounds. So the front teeth, they mainly do the function of cutting. Back teeth, that is molars, they do the function of grinding, and you can see the pressure is about 150 to 250 pounds. So the function of teeth is to cut, grind, and mix the food, and this function is performed with the help of the jaw muscles.